With so many tools available to you in Fusion, it is really easy to lose track of which node is doing what. Some of them, though, are essential to master, as they're going to be the foundation of most, if not all, your compositions. I am Cole, and in this video, I'm going to build a very simple composition to demonstrate what the merge and transform nodes can do, overlapping features, when to use them, and some essential tips. Let's get started. Before we start, if you guys enjoy this type of video where we go in depth on a limited selection of tools while building fun stuff, please let us know in the comments. The merge node is a tool that uses compositing algorithm to merge or blend together two images, and is central to compositing software like Fusion or Nuke. Let's add a merge node by dragging its icon inside a node tree and connect it to the media out. It has three inputs. A yellow one for the background image, green for the foreground, and blue for the mask input. It also has a series of controls to change the foreground position, size, angle to flip the image, and a series of controls to change the compositing algorithm. Now, if you even forget which input is doing what, you can either pass above an input to see what it does, or use a simple motor node, like mix yellow and blue, and you get green on top. I have here three elements that we're going to composite together with a series of merge nodes. A cityscape that has been cropped and color corrected, a text node connected to a corner positioner to have it match the perspective, and a flashy orange car that I color corrected to have it match the mood of the cityscape. Let's connect the background image to the yellow input. I'm going to assign the media out to the viewer and connect the text to the green input. Immediately, the merge node is compositing those two sources into one image, but for now, they are far from blending together. I'm selecting the merge node, and I can use various apply modes and the following adjustment controls. Those are more commonly known as blend modes in softwares like Photoshop, and use simple mathematical formulas to determine how two images are blended together. This operator control only appears when normal or screen mode are selected, and dictates how two images are combined together. I'll demonstrate how this is working later in this video. Subtractive additive is particularly important when you are compositing images with an alpha channel, and will affect the transparency depending if the image has been pre-multiplied or not. I'm going to give you more info on that later in this video, but for the text, I could, for example, set this slider halfway, use the blend mode and the alpha gain to achieve a look that is somewhat okay. A better way to do this would be to change the apply mode to overlay. And I'm going to bring back the blend a little bit. There you go. Immediately, it looks a lot more convincing because the overlay mode is brightening or darkening the foreground pixels to match the underlying brightness. And in this case, this is ideal as we want the text to look as if it was painted over the road, and it needs to be affected naturally by the light and shadows. The following controls are going to be better explained when we start adding more elements, so we'll get back to those in a moment. The Channels tab is only used when you're dealing with images that have Z-depth data embedded into them. This is very useful when you deal with 3D composites that have been imported as EXI images, and we will cover this in a future video. Next, let's add two cars to the scene and at the same time bring the Transform tool into the game. I have here two Transform nodes that we're going to use to manipulate our assets, and if I select one, I can see that there are a lot of controls that are identical to the Merge tool. Actually, let's select the two of them. I'm going to pin them to keep them open together and see what this is about. Those two have a lot in common. They both have a center control, size, angle, flip modes, and a few more thereafter. They vary in some very important ways though, and what may be the most evident is that the Transform tool is designed and dedicated for that single purpose. When you see that node, you know that something was transformed, unlike for the Merge node where you better start adding sticky notes to remember that kind of things. The Transform node also has some very useful tricks like the Pivot mode. Let me show you. I'm connecting the car to the Transform node and then to the main flow by adding a new Merge node. It's a little big, but we're going to fix it. The pivot control allows you to set the axis point for scaling and rotation. And for example, I can set the Y axis at something that makes more sense, like the bottom of the front right tire. This way, it is much faster and natural to position your element and scale it without having to go back and forth between your controls. So I'm just gonna make sure that I have a scale that match what I have in mind. We will adjust that probably later on. You can also rotate it around that same axis, and this is very useful for animating. You can squash or stretch things with aspect, or untick this checkbox to be able to control the X axis and the Y separately. And you can even invert your transform. Now to the more technical stuff that we left aside with the merge node. The edges control lets you decide how the edges of your image are being handled. And with this, you can easily create mosaics, mirror effects, or even duplicate pixels that are all around your image. Where you decide to use this control matters. And in this composition, for example, you will get different results depending if you use it inside the transform node or in the merge. For example, here, if I set it to mirror, I'm getting this reflection at the bottom. While if I go, I'm going to first reset this and go to the transform node, and I choose mirror, I'm getting that psychedelic effect. Now you can see that all the space isn't filled up around, and this is because this is the frame size of the source image, and this is can quickly be fixed by clicking on Flatten Transform. And we can see that immediately it is filling up everything. Flatten Transform is an incredibly important control because in Fusion, transforms are concatenated, meaning that all transforms are passed downstream to the last transform node to be computed all at once rather than consecutively. Why is this important? Because whenever you manipulate an image, the merge and transform nodes are automatically creating and removing pixels by using different filtering methods. The golden rule is that you don't want that to happen more than once, as it can quickly degrade your image. So if you decide to flatten a transform upstream, make sure that no other tool downstream will be transforming your image. For the filter, which one you end up using will greatly depend on the content of your image. Just know that if you're using something like Lensos, which is a more advanced filter, it will take more time to calculate. To add the second car, I can very simply connect the same image source to a second transform node with its own color corrector, and then add another merge node after the first transform. Connect them. Here, I can see that this car should clearly be in the background, and this can be easily fixed by typing Ctrl+T to invert those two inputs. Using the second transform node, it was very simple to manipulate the image independently, for example, by changing the position or flip it using these buttons. You remember the Subtractive additive control? I have the perfect example to test it out. If you look closely at the windscreen, you can see that transparency is brightening the underlying pixels. This is what alpha multiplication is about. And in the case of an image that wasn't pre-multiplied, you need to set the slider towards subtractive. Note that you can also control this directly inside your image loader in the import tab by choosing to post-multiply an image by alpha. The only thing is that you're gonna lose the versatility that you have inside the merge node, that you can choose anything in between. Now that we have those two cars merged together, I can properly demonstrate what the operator control can do. Over is the mode by default, and CP places the foreground above the background image. In only shows the area where both images overlap. Head out, that's a tough one to say, is hiding the foreground pixels by using the background as a mask. Atop is only adding the foreground pixels where it overlaps the background. Engzo is masking the area that is common to both sources. All those modes are very useful to mash up together different elements and build intricate designs. And the last feature I'm going to show you is that if you want to use a mask, for example, a circle polygonal tool, I can connect it to any of my masks, and right away you can see that it's affecting where the area is merging or not. I could also animate that mask to reveal a part of the image. And even more, if I connect that mask to a transform node and invert the mask, I can see that I can make this zoom effect on the image. And there you go. Just by using the tools that we covered in this video, you can create some wild composition. We hope you enjoyed this video. And if you did, give it a thumbs up, and we'll see you in the next one. Take care. See ya.